Okay, so today we're here with the Dart XL Extreme, as you can see, from ZOHD, ZOHD. I said I would do a quick unboxing. I'm not sure if you can hear the rain hitting the roof in the background or not, but it is currently raining, and I expect to have some poor weather for the next week, so I'm not going to rush to get this in the air. So basically today we're just going to take a look at what comes in the box, just kind of a quick teaser, and we'll go from there. But don't expect to see this flying in the next few days or anything like that, because it probably won't be. So, once again, it is the Dart XL from ZOHD. It's kind of a large box. It's hard to fit it all into the camera. But anyway, we mainly want to look at what's inside. I will give you a chance to take a look at the specifications if you want to pause it and read that. But obviously, we will have links to some more product information that you can check out if you are interested in it. So inside the box you have these three individual smaller boxes which are packed very tightly. Move one out. Well, bear with me for a minute. Like I said, they do fit rather tight and they are hard to remove, but that is a good thing for reducing shipping damage. And there we go, we have one out. So inside the first small box, we have these little camera blanking inserts. These are to adapt different styles of cameras within the fuselage, which we will take a look at in just a minute. Let me grab some cameras. Here's three run cams. Run cam HD2. Should insert like so. So we're gonna leave that one there. And now I'm not sure which one of the Runcam 3s would actually made up in this one. It will fit like this. The original 3, which is very comparable to the Session, looks like it will drop right into that one. And I'm assuming this one probably will too. There's not much difference in the size. This one's a little bit wider than this camera. Not sure if you can see the difference in them there. But this one's going to overhang the foam a little bit, and if I don't break it dropping it on the floor, this one does not overhang the foam. So anyway, we will set all of these aside, and we'll come back to that once we get the fuselage out and take a look at it. Propeller is a 9 by 4.5, not sure if you can read that marking on there, but trust me, it's 9 by 4.5. This does appear to be an APC style propeller, not a genuine one. I could be wrong on that, but I doubt it's a genuine APC. APC style propeller is what I'm going to call it for now. I've had mixed results with these in the past, different quality from different suppliers, so we'll give it a chance, give it a shot, see how it works. But I may end up replacing this one with a genuine APC prop. I do believe I have some spares. I'll have to check my box and see. But if not, they're cheap. A couple of dollars for a prop. Little piece of sticky Velcro. And these two long bolts here are going to be used for mounting the wing. And you do have some little plastic standoffs. Well, nylon standoffs and screws for mounting a flight controller, which we will take a look at later. And we have a decal as well as this front cover for the fuselage with a couple of different punch outs. You have a round one here and another round one over this way. It's going to be for your HD camera and your FPV cam. And you can either leave them in or take them out depending on what you want. And I recommend tracing this out on a piece of paper first, because you can easily probably cut this out of some vinyl decals or whatever. This one does appear to be kind of a little rigid plastic, but if you need to change these out later with different cameras and things like that, you can easily replace this. Just make your little template for it, just have on hand. And last thing in this box is the little not sure if they're vortex generators or wing fences, but there's a lot of these in the bag here, a stack of them that will be glued onto the leading edge of the wing on the top surface, which you'll be able to see in just a bit. make more sense.
So let's set this all aside. Put it all back in the box. All right, now this larger box here, we'll take a look at. This one contains some papers. This one is your ESC manual for different programming options for ESC. And I guess this is going to be a user guide, is what they're calling it. Kind of a list of everything included, how to assemble everything, some basic stuff. I'm really not sure if it's even needed. It's a very simple assembly based on what I've seen so far. But it's there if you want it. And let's see, inside this package, will it open? Yes, it will. I have one of your tail fins, vertical fin stabilizers, and I believe this is going to be your little locking component here for securing it into the wing, which we'll take a look at in a bit. So let's see that one over here. And here's one of your wing panels. So you can get it open. So this is going to be your right-hand wing panel. It's the leading edge here. Couple of things to note immediately when taking it out of the bag. I notice you do have a nice little plastic leading edge protection glued onto the wing. I really like that. Servo comes pre-installed. It is a digital Metal Gear servo. There's no size marked on it. It appears to be about a 12-gram servo. And just looking at the case, I don't want to be misquoted. I don't want to be, you know, put out some wrong information, basically. But just looking at the case, if I'm not mistaken, this appears to be a rebranded Emacs servo. But once again, don't quote me on that. It's just, it looks similar to me from the outside. That's what I'm getting at. Based on the top cover and the size and shape of the servo and everything, it looks a lot like the Emacs servos. Which, if that's the case, I would really be happy about that because it's one of my favorite servos. I tend to prefer the analog version better. If this is that same servo anyway, I prefer the analog version of it over the digital. But this may be a totally different servo. So I don't, like I said, I don't want to be misquoted, giving out some wrong information. So I could be very wrong about that. Standard Z-band and the pushrod, little plastic clevis here, and plastic control horn. These are not the strongest looking in the world. They probably gonna hold up just fine, but if they're not, they'll be easy to replace. Could be possible upgrade, something to consider. I do see a carbon spar inserted into the wing here. You can see it running right along there. And there's a little rod in the elevon. And here's a plastic skid plate on the bottom of the wing. You have this little plastic insert which is going to key into the fuselage. You have a tube here where another carbon spar will insert, which spans both wings for strength and support. And then you have this little plastic piece here with integrated connectors, which is going to be your wiring for this servo, as well as, I believe, there's a spare connector right in there. You'll have to, I guess, just fish it out or maybe remove this connector to get to it. I'm not 100% sure about that. You can take a look at that later, but you'll be able to run wiring out through this little pre-cut channel in the foam, and there's a little pre-marked cutout here, which appears it would be about the right size. I don't have a video transmitter handy. Actually, I do. Give me just 1 second. So this is a typical 1.3 gigahertz video transmitter, and if you look at the marking on the wing there, it's the perfect length and width for it. So yes, this will hold a 1.3 transmitter quite nicely, and you'll have to trim out a little bit for your antenna, whichever antenna you decide to use, and run a channel back down there. One thing to note, there's 3 pins are going to be occupied by the servo, and you have a remaining 3, so there's no way to run audio out to your transmitter. Normally you could just put a microphone out on the wing with the transmitter if you wanted audio, but personally, I'm more concerned with audio alerts from the vector, which I will be putting a vector into this one. So I need my audio channel rewired back into my fuselage. So we may address that later, even after we run a separate wire. Just for the audio, it's not a big deal. Just something to keep in mind. So that's what your wing panels look like. We'll sit this one aside. Well, actually, we can install this vertical stabilizer just to see how it fits. You see you have this slot, this little plastic tab here with a slot through the wing here. Plug it right in like so. And when you flip it over, you'll grab the little tab here, the little knob. And turn it and lock it in place. That quick, that easy. Very secure, very, very nice tight fit. I like it. To remove it, you just turn the tab the other way and pull it out. That quick. So I really like that. The other two should be the same. The other wing panel and winglet. So once again, you have the same little mount here for your other vertical fin, same leading edge protection, same plastic housing and connector here, same plastic tab to key into the fuselage, same skid plate slot for mounting, same pre-mounted servo, same linkage, same carbon spars, everything just mirrored on this side basically. One thing I didn't point out on the other wing panel just a minute ago, these slots here are where the little plastic tabs are going to go. Whether they're vortex generators or wing fences, I'm not 100% sure what their intended purpose is for. But what I will do is link to Andrew, his channel below this one. He has done some, extensive testing, but he's done some very informative, thorough testing on the wing plastic pieces. And just this little foam block, I just noticed, I felt it move in my hand. They're actually already pre-cut, the little foam blocks. And there's one on both sides. I didn't realize they were already cut out. I thought they were just marked. But they're actually already cut. So you get a nice smooth finish in the bottom of the cutout there in the cavity. So that's a nice feature. And put a drop of glue or tape over them, whatever, if you're not going to remove it. So that's nice. But anyway, getting back to the little wing pieces here, I will link to his channel where you can check out a video explaining some more about how they work and how they don't. So, set that one aside, and in the last little bag here, you have the remaining vertical fin stabilizer. So we'll set all of these aside. And last but not least, actually gonna move the large box. And take a look in the last small box. Should be your fuselage. As well as carbon spar. So there's the fuselage and the carbon spar. This is basically just an extruded carbon fiber rod, or tube rather, that will insert through the wings and through the fuselage. Right through there, as you would expect. So, getting on with the fuselage itself. Here, this front piece on the fuselage is molded plastic. This is where your FPV camera lens will poke through, as well as your HD cameras. I see you have a square cutout, which will be for a GoPro style. Some of the newer GoPros. And there's a round one here if you're running a Mobius or Runcam 2 or something like that. That's going to stick through here. Not 100% sure how that works out, but we will take a look at that in just a bit. And this plastic piece here has the mating connector for the wing, where the wing's going to plug into there. That plastic piece on the wing roots that I say will key into the fuselage, they plug into this hole here, which is surrounded by laser cut plywood, which is glued into the fuselage, so it's nice and strong, sturdy, it's not going to wear out. Same thing on the opposite side over here. Looking on the bottom of the fuselage, you do have a nice plastic skid plate to complement the two in the wings. And this rear hatch is already loose, so we'll remove it. See, it keys into the front with a tab, locks into the fuselage. And the back side here is going to be secured by these two screws, which are currently backed out. Tighten those two screws to hold the back of the hatch down here. So we'll remove it and set it aside for a minute. Actually, we'll take a look at it. The cooling, you have this little plastic mesh kind of insert in the front air duct to let air in. And this is not open. These are just kind of molded for extra detail, I guess, in the foam piece. And the rear has it's plywood. It's a wood insert glued into the back with some slots cut out to let the air exit out of the back. So that's going to let air in and flow over your speed controller and flow back around your motor too. Didn't particularly offer any special cooling for the motor, but it's going to let plenty of air through your speed controller. And one thing I do notice, the ESC comes zip tied down to this little plywood plate. I'm not sure if you can see it, but the plywood plate is actually cracked in mine. I guess that was damaged in shipping. Yeah, it's just kind of sitting there. So, the plywood plate seems to be glued into this side of the fuselage and not this one. And the plate itself is broken, so we will need to repair that or replace it. Not sure. Should be just a quick, simple fix. I don't think it's a structural component. We'll probably just sit it back in place, dribble some glue down in there, and glue the plywood back. It just kind of snaps back in place. So that'll be a quick and easy fix. I guess it was damaged in shipping. Not a big deal. It's just a nice little shelf which lets airflow under the ESC as well as over it to help cool it better. Staying with the back of the fuselage, we're going to take a look at the motor. This is a ZOHD branded MK2 series 2216 1300 kV motor. And I believe, once again, please quote me if I'm wrong. If someone from ZOHD is watching this, maybe they can confirm or correct me if needed. I do believe this is a rebranded Sunny Sky 2216 motor. If that's the case, I'm really happy about that. I really hope it is. The prop mount, the motor itself, the wiring, everything, the X mount under there, everything looks exactly like a Sunny Sky motor, just rebranded with their name. I really hope that's the case, because that would be my motor of choice for this wing if it didn't already come mounted on it. The ESC itself is a ZOHD branded 30 amp ESC, a 3 amp 5 volt BEC. I'm not sure if that's switching or linear. I will probably disable it and use an external one to be safe. Battery rating is 2 to 4S. Lithium polymer voltage is 16.8 volt max. So we will be running it on 4S. One quick thing I note, if you're a little signal lead battery cable which runs to the front, we'll take a look at that in a bit. They added a nice little GST connector which runs off of the main battery wires. So you can power your FPV gear right off of the ESC, off the main power going into the ESC, which is really nice. I usually solder one of these onto my current sensor output. This is basically already done for me. It's just going to take the battery power from your current sensor and run it to the ESC and back out to this plug. So that's a nice feature to have. Save you a lot of time and work. Now these two leads here, one is going to be the servo, one is going to be the extra three pins in the wire. There's one on each side, two servo connectors per wing. So that can be whatever you choose to mount in the wings and run through the extra three pins. And the other three pins is going to be your Elevon servo, one on each side. Pretty standard stuff. And I said I would re-mention those little plastic standoffs, little nylon standoffs. This little plate right down here is an intended spot for your flight controller. See, there's a little hex shape cut out, four of them in each corner of the plate for your flight controller. For those standoffs, you would drop those standoffs right in down in there, plug them into the foam, put a drop of glue just to hold them in place, and screw a board down on there if you want to use like iNav or something like that. But like I said, I will be attempting to mount a full-size Vector in this particular one myself. That's what I want to fly it with, so we're going to put in it. Battery hatch is rather secure. You have a nice little, it's actually a carbon fiber tab. Not sure if that's going to show up well, but it's real carbon fiber. Little tab glued in there. It's a nice touch. And you have two magnets in the fuselage here and two matching ones in the back of the hatch. And the front is locked in with these two tabs, like so. So it's nice and secure and quickly removed. In the front half of the fuselage here, you have a plywood plate, pre-installed Velcro battery strap, and these little markings to keep track of where your battery needs to be to keep your center of gravity once you have everything mounted in balance. So that's nice. You'll be able to just put a little reference mark on it, whatever, or use the ones already there. Nice little Dart XL Extreme logo engraved right into there. And not sure how well you can see it, but right in there is where your cameras are going to go. You have a cutout for FPV camera. Let me see. I actually have one sitting on my bench here. It's an old Fox Ear. What is the arrow? I'm not sure if the lens is not too big. Yes, it is. The lens is actually too big to fit in there, so we're not going to be able to try this one. So I have to use one of the smaller lens. I'll take a look. Collection of cameras. I reviewed quite a lot and have some spare cameras. Sure, I have something that'll work. We'll put a flight camera in there as well as an HD camera on the side. And you see you actually have plenty of cooling air inlet right in there. So let air into the fuselage, cool your cameras and flow around it, I guess. I just want to see, for example, like the RunCam HD2 in the foam block. I just want to see how that's going to fit. So actually, no, once you have an HD camera in place, it pretty much blocks all of the airflow through that front vent, which is kind of a bummer. I thought it'd be pretty handy for cooling, but maybe it's just cool your camera. I'm not sure what the intended purpose is, but your battery is going to be right in here, and there's actually no cooling vent in the front hatch, so you actually won't get a lot of air to cool your battery. Air is going to go into the rear hatch right here and exit back here, cooling the electronics in the back of the fuselage. If that proves to be an issue, you could easily cut a little air insert, a little air inlet rather, in the front of the hatch, cool your battery if needed. I don't expect it to be an issue though. Just something I kind of figuring out now with you. So that's how the camera blanking pieces, adapters, whatever you want to call them, how they work. I actually wanted to try again, I'm not really sure the intended purpose how these work. So the RunCam 3, the older version, the regular RunCam HD3, is going to sit right in there, and you see you have the HD camera lens looking right out there. Try to get that little lighting where you can see it. So that's going to work there, and it's back in the box, but that cover I showed you, that little sticker that's included will cover this hole here. If you're not going to use it, you can put that to cover up the extra. So let's take a look at the 3S and see how it fits. I'm going to slide this one out. I just want to see how the 3S fits, because it is a little bit wider. So yes, it actually is a nice, perfect snug fit. So the 3S plugs right down into there, just like the 3. It's a little bit tighter fit, but it does fit. And the lens does line up perfectly with the cutout in the front of the fuselage, so that's nice. You'll be able to use either one of those, or a GoPro session is going to be the exact same size as this one. And I believe, speaking of GoPro, give me 1 minute. I don't have my GoPro handy, but I do have this Explorer K from Rexo, which is basically a GoPro clone, very similar to a GoPro, same size, shape, and form factor. I believe a GoPro will sit right in here without any additional foam. This particular one is actually a little bit loose. Maybe the hatch will hold it. Oh, I'm dropping things again, so bear with me. So, no, it's still rather loose. Actually, quite a bit loose. So I'm not sure how you would mount a GoPro unless you would maybe cut a piece of foam to put behind it, or perhaps put a piece of one of these would actually hold it right in there. I would choose to cut one out of something else because I don't want to cut those two. But so that's your different camera mount options. And like I said, the Hero 4, I think the 4 has a square thing. Actually, it does not. Some of the newer GoPros have this, but my 4 doesn't. But they have the big square surround around the lens. You'd be able to put that. So you'll need to cut a little block of foam, do a little bit of tinkering if you want to mount a GoPro. Let's move these HD cameras out of the way just a bit. And just take a quick look at how everything actually fits together. Obviously the hatches are going to fit like we already looked at. So I would actually need to get a screwdriver and tighten the screws to secure the rear hatch. Not going to do that just yet. I'm just going to set this hatch aside. So let's take a look at mounting the wings. Give me a minute. I need to get those screws. These two. So these will be inserted into the fuselage like so, with the knob on the inside and the threaded portion sticking out, which will thread into these little metal brass inserts right in here in the plastic piece. Not sure how well you can see them, but they're in there. You'll want to keep these, keep in mind, you'll need to install those before you mount your flight controller if it's going to stick up above the end of these, because once you have something mounted in here, you're not going to be able to remove these because they are rather long. So just keep that in mind. They'll need to go in place pretty early on. Then the wing is going to plug right in here. Now you're going to need to line up the connector right in there. Sorry, I'm trying to keep everything in frame. You're going to need to line up the connector right in there, and this black plastic tab here is going to key into the rear of the fuselage. Just plug that in place like so. Push everything home. And doesn't seem to want to bite the threads. There it goes. Just gotta squeeze it in place, and then you can snug that up. And then that wing is securely mounted. And you will need to insert your spar through the fuselage and into your other wing, like so. Keep everything secure. So we will then plug in the other wing panel, which will slide over the spar like so. And then we'll tighten up the nut on that one, like so. So the wings are mounted now. They're securely in place. So we will plug in the vertical fins. Lock that one in place. Do the same on that side. And that's it. Build's basically done. As far as building the airframe itself, you'll need to insert these little tabs on the wing and glue them in place, and the hatch will need to be mounted. But I mean, besides all your electronics and mounting the prop and everything, that's it. That's it. Literally goes together that quick. And I'm not sure how well you can tell the size, the scale. I can actually sit my Nano Talon on it. Let me grab it. My ZOHD Nano Talon. Flat wing mod, I'm sure you've all seen it. But yeah, it's the Nano Talon is noticeably smaller. So another plane you're probably familiar with is the AR Wing Sonic model. Same people that make ZOHD. ZOHD is a sub company of Sonic model, basically. But anyway, this AR wing, which I fly occasionally on my channel, you may have seen it. Span on the Dart XL is a little bit bigger than the AR wing. Obviously, you have more wing area with the Dart XL and more fuselage, because there's no fuselage at all on the little wing. But it's not a lot bigger. It's more plain without being terribly large, basically. So I like what I see so far. As far as the foam quality, the molding quality, everything fits together nice. It's nice contrasting black and white. I like the colors. It seems to be the same high quality molding as all of the other ZOHD plane Sonic models that I've had in the past. So far, it doesn't leave a lot to be desired. It looks great. I think it does. You'll have to decide that for yourself. But I'm really looking forward to getting it in the air and flying it and seeing what it does. And like I said, we will be mounting a Vector flight controller in this one. And some 1.3 gigahertz FPV gear, as well as a UHF Dragon Link receiver. So stay tuned for that. Like I said, I'm not going to rush to get this in the air. This video is actually going on too long, rambling on quite a lot about it. But we're going to get some electronics in it and get it set up and flown as soon as possible. But like I said, the weather is not looking great, so there's no rush. So I'm probably going to take my time and do a couple of more videos, maybe showing how I choose to install some of the electronics that I do put into it. And we'll go from there. So I'll go ahead and end this one now. So thank you for watching. Thank you to ZOHD for supplying this for review. Do check out some links below the video. I will have links to the airplane, so you can check it out yourself, or you can purchase one. As far as I know right now, Banggood is the only place to get it. They were offering a pre-order. Some of the people that pre-ordered are having issues getting their model shipped out right now. But I haven't really followed that very closely, so I can't really comment on it much. But as far as I'm aware, Banggood is the only place to order it if you want to order one right now. So I will have links to there where you can do so, as well as some of the other videos if you want to check them out. Some of the other people have actually gotten theirs in the air already and flown them, and I like what I see so far. So stay tuned. We're going to do a build on this and get it in the air and hopefully make some enjoyable video for you to watch. So see you then.